If we compare a hot object to a cold object, the difference on a microscopic scale is that we have more movement inside the hot object. The same thing is true with circuits and electrons in particular. If you have a very cold circuit and it's not hooked up to a power supply, the electrons are still going to be moving around, but they're not going to be moving around as much as the situation if you put the same circuit in a hot room. In a hot room, the electrons are going to be moving all over the place. On average, they're not going to be moving at all, but at any given moment in time, you're going to have some electrons moving one way and some electrons moving another. The hotter the room or the hotter the environment, the more movement that you're going to have. All of this movement around of electrons in a circuit results in noise, and the kind of noise that we're going to be talking about here in this video is called thermal noise or Johnson noise. In my previous video on noise in amplifiers, I described the need to have a resistor in order to model that noise. In this situation, we're going to consider a hot resistor. It could be just a conductor. It doesn't necessarily have to be a resistor. We're just going to model it as such because all electronic components are going to have resistors. And anytime you have electrons moving around, scattering off of each other, you're going to have some dissipation of power. If something is dissipating power, if it's hot, it needs to have a resistance. That's just the nature of resistance. Our hot resistor can be modeled as a voltage source in series with a noiseless resistor because our source of heat can be modeled as a power source. Although we have a power source here in our circuit, and that's due to the thermal noise, we're not going to be able to extract power from that circuit and do useful work due to the thermal noise unless the rest of our circuit is in a cold room. That's the nature of the laws of thermodynamics. If our load is also in the hot room, then it's going to transfer noise back to our source and the two effects will balance out, preventing you from extracting any useful power. If I were to have a hot resistor in a room, or just any circuit for that matter, that's not hooked up to a power supply, but it's hot, and I measure the voltage across two parts of the circuit, in this situation, the two ends of the resistor, and I use an oscilloscope to graph voltage with respect to time, I'm going to get some graph that looks like the one that I'm showing right now, voltage versus time. The difference, of course, from the voltage you measure on the oscilloscope from what I'm graphing here is going to be the scaling, the amount of voltage that you're going to see and the time period as well. Thermal noise has the property that the probability distribution function is almost Gaussian. What that means is that you're most likely to find voltages that are close to zero, and you're less likely to find voltages farther away from zero at any given moment in time. If I were to graph the probability distribution of Gaussian noise, I'll find an approximately Gaussian function here. We're most likely to find voltages near zero, and then we're less likely to find voltages in either direction from zero. That's exactly what we see here in our plot of the noise. In terms of the spectrum, thermal noise is pretty much white, meaning it's the same at all frequencies. I mentioned in the last video that that's actually impossible because if you try to find the power contained in the noise and you have to integrate over all frequencies and it's flat, then you'll calculate an infinite amount of power. So in a practical situation, thermal noise does eventually roll off. Now it turns out that at room temperature, the bandwidth roll-off for thermal noise is up in the terahertz range. So for all intents and purposes, thermal noise is basically white. In other words, it's having a flat frequency response. Let's take a look back at something I derived in the previous video. That is the noise spectral density. I wasn't referring specifically to thermal noise when I calculated this expression for the noise amplitude spectral density in the last video, but because thermal noise is basically white noise, the same derivation applies. Let's go through it again just to remind ourselves what was done. First, I considered the case of white noise. In other words, the power density is flat with respect to frequency. Then I assume that we're going to be operating over our particular band of frequencies. The bandwidth here is delta F. The power can be found by integrating the power density over the band of frequencies that we're going to operate at. Now, one thing that I should mention at this point is that when we made the last video, I only included the positive frequencies. Some people like to include the negative frequencies as well, and if that's done, then you'll end up with an extra factor of 2 here right in front of the integral. It might appear something like this. That can be really annoying, and it all boils down to how S is defined, whether or not the negative frequencies are rolled into the definition of the power density or not. So you have to be aware that sometimes you'll see weird factors of two popping out of these equations. The average power can be very easily found in the case of white noise because it's just flat, and we can take this integral by just multiplying S times delta F. Recalling that the average power is the square of the RMS voltage divided by R, it becomes relatively straightforward to find out what the RMS voltage due to the noise is going to be. Let's now look at the case of thermal noise in particular. Using my definition for S, the power density, and assuming that we're only integrating over the positive frequencies, then it can be shown that S is going to be equal to 4KT, where K is Boltzmann's constant, and T is the temperature of the environment or of the resistor in Kelvin. 4KT is just a constant in any particular circuit, which means that the power density is constant. In other words, thermal noise is just white noise. Let's now find out what the RMS voltage would be for a particular temperature over a particular bandwidth for a resistor that's hot. We know that power is RMS voltage squared divided by resistance. All I need to do now is just rearrange the terms in order to find the RMS voltage here. Let's work a little example to show how this expression can be used. Let's assume that we had a 50 ohm resistor and it's going to be at room temperature, which is about 300 Kelvin. We can plug in Boltzmann's constant, our temperature, and our resistance into this equation. Let's see what the RMS voltage is going to be over a bandwidth of 1 hertz. If we plug in all those numbers, we get 9.1 times 10 to minus 10 volts. If we round 9.1 to 10, we wind up with 1 nanovolt. It's a good rule of thumb to keep in mind, that is, a 50 ohm resistor at room temperature over a bandwidth of just 1 hertz will give you an RMS voltage due to the noise of about a nanovolt. Let's now look at a more proper example. Let's find the RMS voltage for a 1 kilo ohm resistor at room temperature over a 20 kilohertz bandwidth. First, let's copy down our equation from the previous slide. Then we can plug in Boltzmann's constant, our temperature, our resistance, and our bandwidth. And we come up with an answer of 575.5 nanovolts. That's not a very high voltage, but it gives you some idea of the kind of noise level that you can expect from such a resistor at room temperature. What's the maximum amount of power that the above resistor can deliver to the rest of a circuit? Now, in this case, we could, for example, assume that the rest of the circuit is in a super cold room so that the power could actually be delivered to a load resistor. The source of the power in this situation would be the thermal bath in the hot room, which is going to empty into the colder room when the load resistor dissipates that power. If our load resistor is in the same room or at thermal equilibrium as a source resistor, then both resistors are going to transfer power to one another. In either case, we can use the maximum power transfer theorem in order to determine how much power is actually going to be transferred in one direction. There's the RMS source of our noise. It's a power source, and that power is derived from the thermal bath in which the resistor is sitting. Here's the resistor itself. I'm just going to call it R. This R corresponds to the 1 kilo ohm resistor for which we calculated that RMS voltage in example 1. I'm going to represent the rest of the circuit by another resistor. Now let's look at what the question asks us. It asks us what the maximum power that can be transferred is. Well, we know in which situation maximum power will be transferred from the maximum power transfer theorem. Maximum power will be transferred when the load resistor is equal to the source resistor. In a real situation, we know that the load resistor might not be equal to R, but we're going to assume that it is because the problem is asking us to find what the maximum power that could hypothetically be transferred is. The voltage is going to divide evenly across these two resistors because they're equal to one another, and then I can just find the average power across the load resistor because I know its voltage. I'm going to use the formula V squared over R, V being VRMS over 2 for the load resistor. Let's move the 2 squared down into the denominator. At this point, I could just substitute in the RMS voltage that I found in example 1, but I'm going to continue the derivation so we have a clean answer in any case. Let's just square this expression here. Let's also rewrite R sub L as R, which is going to be the case with maximum power transfer. We're left with just three terms, Boltzmann's constant times the temperature times the bandwidth. we wind up with a very small amount of power being dissipated. Let's extend our discussion a little bit. We'll assume that this resistor is at a temperature of 300 Kelvin, and we'll assume that this temperature is close to absolute zero. Under such a scenario, if the rooms were perfectly sealed, except for the wire connecting one part of the circuit to the other part of the circuit, energy would flow from the hot room to the cold room and would be dissipated from our load resistor. The rate of energy dissipation would be 8.28 times 10 to minus 17 watts. Once the cold room starts getting hotter, though, our load resistor will then start to have some thermal energy of its own, which will then flow back to the source side. So on average, this process will continue until the two sides of the room reach thermal equilibrium. Even if our load resistor, however, were also in the hot room, our calculation here is still valid. It's just that that power transfer would take place in both directions simultaneously. When we design electrical circuits, we want the noise to be as negligible as possible. We don't want to have noise at all because it could overwhelm our signals inside of our circuit. What can we do when we design electrical circuits in order to minimize the noise? In order to answer that, let's take a look at the equation that we've come up with in this video. We can see that the RMS voltage of the noise, and thus the power that's transferred around the circuit as a result of the noise, is directly dependent upon three different quantities: the temperature, the resistance, and the bandwidth. Therefore, when you design electrical circuits, it's important to give some consideration to the temperature. You don't want your circuit to get hot, otherwise it will generate noise. Secondly, in terms of the resistance, small resistors tend to be less noisy compared to larger resistance, so keep that in mind. Thirdly, because the noise is related to the bandwidth, it's important to not allow circuits to operate over excessively wide bandwidths. For example, if you're trying to design an amplifier that's going to work over audio frequencies, there's no need to design it to work over radio frequencies as well. The larger bandwidth will do nothing but make your circuit a little bit noisier. So again, in order to minimize the effect of noise on the circuits, keep the temperature down, use smaller resistors, and don't operate over excessively large bandwidths.